Hey, it's Professor Dave. Let's talk about amides.
He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave explains.
We've looked at a few different carbonyl-containing functional groups and their derivatives, so let's look at one more, the amide. As we recall, these consist of a carbonyl adjacent to a nitrogen atom, with the nitrogen bonded to two other groups, either hydrogen or alkyl in some combination. There is a lot to talk about with amides, both in the context of their synthesis and their role in nature, so let's start out by getting a more sophisticated understanding of this functional group and its properties. Let's start out by looking at a very simple amide, dimethyl formamide, or DMF. This has two methyls on the nitrogen atom, and the common prefix form is referring to the lack of alkyl on the other side of the carbonyl, just like with formaldehyde or formic acid. DMF is a common organic solvent, which is polar, aprotic, and miscible with water, so we will encounter this in the lab quite frequently. One of the most interesting things about amides is the energy barrier for rotation around the CN bond, which is substantial. We know that sigma bonds can rotate freely, so this may seem unexpected, but we must realize that amides have a Zwitter-ionic resonance structure, whereby the lone pair on the nitrogen forms a pi bond to carbon, which kicks this pi bond up to form the oxyanion. This resonance structure is not as strongly contributing as the other, due to the presence of formal charges, but it still contributes to the composite, which means there is partial pi bond character between carbon and nitrogen, and this is what limits the rotation around this bond. This is not limited to conjecture with Lewis dot structures. There is actually very strong empirical evidence for this fact in the way of X-ray data, which invariably shows that amides are planar about this region, just like alkenes, which is indicative of the strong double bond character. This is in stark contrast with amines, which are pyramidal, as the lone pair occupies one of the vertices of a tetrahedron, which the lone pair on the nitrogen in the amide does not do because of resonance. In addition, if we look at IR spectroscopy data, the carbonyl stretch for DMF shows up at a wave number of around 1675, as opposed to a ketone, which shows up at 1700 or above. This means it takes less energy to stretch the carbonyl in an amide than in a ketone, which is indicative of the fact that the carbonyl in the ketone is localized, whereas in the amide it is delocalized. Chemists have calculated that the free energy barrier of rotation around this CN bond in DMF is around 20 kilocalories per mole, and this is rather typical of amides. This is quite an impressive figure to have calculated, which was actually derived from NMR data. A typical 400 MHz proton NMR spectrum of DMF at room temperature shows these two methyls as two distinct signals, indicating that they are fixed in place and thus not chemically equivalent. But if you warm up the probe, slowly the two signals broaden and coalesce into a singlet located exactly at the midpoint of the two former signals. By measuring the behavior of the signals versus temperature and using a complex formula derived from the standard block equations that we won't go into here, we can obtain the activation energy for the rotation around this bond that would be required to make these methyls chemically equivalent. Now that we've looked at DMF for a while, let's try another amide. How about secondary amides, whereby the nitrogen is bonded to one hydrogen and one alkyl group? This means the amide can exist as two isomers, which can be assigned E and Z absolute configuration, according to the Kahn-Ingold prelog convention that we already know. In practice, however, most chemists simply refer to these as either cis or trans, to indicate the relative position of the alkyl groups. Looking at this equilibrium between the cis and trans isomers of a secondary amide, an energy on the order of 20 kcals per mole, which could allow for free rotation around the CN bond, making these conformers rather than isomers. But with cis and trans isomers of amides, the trans is much more stable for reasons of sterics, just like we saw with alkenes. So they will exist as 90 to 99% as the trans isomer in equilibrium with small amounts of the cis isomer. You may wonder why we are fixated on secondary amides. Well, if you have made it over to my biochemistry playlist yet, you will know that secondary amides are the basis of proteins, as when amino acids polymerize, they will form peptide bonds, which are secondary amides. Biochemists have determined that of all the amino acid residues in all the proteins in the body, less than 0.1% of them contain cis peptide bonds, for the reasons we have just discussed. But this small amount does play a definite role in protein structure, as well as the rate at which they rotate and fold into the most stable conformation. One other property of amides that is relevant to protein structure is their stability. Amides are not particularly susceptible to hydrolysis, which is important since biomolecules are surrounded by water, and we can't have them falling apart all the time, or life could not exist. The half-life of a typical biological amide has been estimated as 7 years, which is quite the sweet spot. As we said, if they were a little less stable, they would fall apart too easily. But if they were a little more stable, then it would have been too difficult for enzymes to have evolved that are able to promote hydrolysis of peptide bonds, which would mean that metabolizing proteins would be impossible, and there would be no way for cells to get the amino acid building blocks needed to build all the cellular machinery. If it takes 100 years to digest a cheeseburger, that's not a very good recipe for life, so we owe a lot to the very particular stability of the amide. Later on, we will spend some time talking about protein synthesis, not in the context of a cell, but from the perspective of laboratory organic synthesis, as this is a fascinating area of study that has progressed tremendously in the past few decades. But for now, we can just be satisfied with an enhanced understanding of amides and their properties. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.